Hi, I'm Carl Franklin. In this episode of Blazor Train, I'll show you a few different ways to modify your user interface based on whether or not it's being consumed on a mobile device. Just like in life, there's usually more than one way to do things, and it's up to you to decide which method you prefer for your application. Mobile web UI is our next stop, coming up right now, right here on Blazor Train! So we're talking mobile web here, all right? So this is a Blazor app where you want to modify the experience for mobile users, and you want it to be a different experience in terms of the UI. You can already see this in action in the default Blazor template. If you just run it and then make the app smaller, and as it gets to a certain width, things change. So I've created just a single Blazor server application here called Mobile UI. I haven't done anything to it. Let me just show you what I mean here. So here it is, hello world. And I'm gonna make it smaller and smaller, and then all of a sudden, whoop, what happened? Things just went away. Well, okay, so this nav bar over here went to the top, and we also got this little button right here that allows us to drop down the nav bar. Now, this nav bar is actually just a Bootstrap nav bar. In fact, if you go to getbootstrap.com or just search for Bootstrap nav bar, you can see that the documentation shows you how it works, and it even has a nice little demo of it right here. And even the demo does what our Blazor template does. Let me see if I can make this smaller. There it goes. So it's got a button here. However, you might notice that the sample code is a bit different here. Like there's a data toggle collapse, a data target. There's a bit more stuff here than is in the nav bar that we have in our Blazor template. So we're gonna do this three ways. We're gonna control the mobile UI in three different ways. One with CSS, one with JavaScript, and one with Blazor. So the CSS solution is based on the size of the display, the width, right? The minimum width. You can see this happening if you go to shared, nav menu, Razor CSS. You can see right here, there's a media query. So what's going on here is that if our browser is 641 pixels wide or wider, then in the navbar toggler class, we're going to hide it. Set display equals none. This is CSS, right? In the collapse class, we're going to display. So I know that you can't really get the whole thing from this, but this is the general idea. Let me simplify it for you. Let's go back to fetch data, and I'll put a little div right down at the bottom here. All right, so this div is using the class non-mobile, and it says there are at forecasts length forecasts, right? So now we have to get a class called non-mobile. So what I'll do just to localize it to fetch data is we'll add a fetchData.razor.css and just put that class in there. Non-mobile is going to default to being hidden, display none. But when we're 641 pixels or greater, we're going to show it, display block. All right, so this is basically a very simple class that when it's 641 pixels or wider, we're going to display it. And when we're less than 641 pixels wide, we won't. Now again, going back to our div class equals non-mobile, this should only show up when we're not compressed. All right, here's our fetch data. There you can see there are five forecasts. And if I do this, boom, goes away. Now, here's another thing that you can do. You can actually add this class to any element that you don't want to show. So this class equals non-mobile. Let's say we don't want to show the temperature in Celsius when we're mobile or when we're at a lower width. All right, so I put the class on this one and on this one. All we're doing is saying, hey, you know, if we're so wide, show it, but if we're not, don't show it. All right, so there it is. We have our temp Celsius and boom, just goes away. So this is a nice CSS-based solution, but it does have its limitations. What if you want to do some code that inspects whether the screen is a certain width or not, a certain size, and then do things or show things based on that using code, you know, using this kind of stuff. You know, if we're mobile, then show something. Otherwise, show something else. Maybe you want to do that. So for that, we can use JavaScript. So I'm going to go into my underscore host CSHTML right there and add a little bit of script. So we've got this script. I've got a variable called Blazor page, which is going to be a Blazor page reference that we pass in with JavaScript interop. The method is window.register for resize events. And when that happens, we're going to save off that Blazor page and set a reference to it. And now I have an event listener for the resize on the window. So that means anytime the browser gets resized, this is going to happen. So I've got this raise event internal function that I call on a timeout just after 1 millisecond, just to get me out of the call stack, right? It's just a little stupid JavaScript trick I learned. Essentially, we're going to call that with the component and the event name and the X and the Y, and it's going to call invoke method async on window resized. That's our event name. So in C#, I have to have a JS invocable method called onWindowResized that accepts a width and a height integer. I have to call that immediately after calling register for resize events because I need to know what that width and height are, you know, initially. So now let's rewrite fetchDataRaiser to handle this. All right, so I've got an IJS runtime there for JavaScript runtime. And let's go down here. And you can see I've still got this CSS thing in there, but I've also got all this right here. Window width and window height, which are integers. And on after render async, I have to do this here. Otherwise, the JavaScript system isn't initialized. It doesn't work. You can't use uninitialized async. You can't call JavaScript in there. So you have to wait until it renders the first time. And .NET object reference.create, this is my page, a reference to my page, which the JavaScript is going to use to call back on window resized. And all I'm doing here is setting my window width and height and calling state has changed. So now, keeping with our 631 pixels, if my window width is greater than 631, I'm going to show this div. Right? So it's similar, but now I'm using JavaScript, so I can start inspecting variables that come back from JavaScript. All right. Here's our window width. Let me bump this up a little bit. And when we get down to a certain width, boom, there it is. I guess it would be better if you could see it, huh? There. So not at all being shown when we're below 631. And when we're above that, it shows it. So you got to think about the pros and cons of CSS versus JavaScript. We're using both of these here. But these are only based on the width of the screen. How can you tell if there's an actual mobile device that's connected? Well, that's different. So let's go back to our underscore host and change that. So check this out. This underscore host CSHTML happens on every refresh. So every time the page, because it is a SPA, so every time the page is reloaded, and I don't mean go from page to page, I mean you press refresh, right? Then this is going to happen. And we're looking at the user agent from the request headers, user agent. And then we're looking to see if that user agent string contains any of these types that indicate mobile platforms. Now, this mobile right there is going to cover a host of SYNs and Android as well. But there are also a couple other ones that you might want to look for as well. So all we're doing here is getting this is mobile Boolean true or false based on the user agent. Now, how do we get that into our application? Well, this is a really cool trick. We're going to deck out the app object, the app razor page, and we're going to add a parameter called isMobile. And then we can hook the navigation in there in the app, and based on whether it's mobile or not, we can reroute to different pages. So let's start by adding app.razor.cs. So this is a code behind for our app. Public partial class app. We're implementing iDisposable, which is cool. Here's our isMobile parameter. We're injecting the navigation manager. Now, we've got uninitialized our navigation manager location change. We're going to handle that event with this delegate, onLocationChanged. And here's our onLocationChanged delegate, and all we're doing there is calling navCheck. So I'm getting the nav path, in other words, where are we navigating to, from the navigation manager URI, local path to lower. And now I'm saying if isMobile, which we know is true or false, and the nav path does not start with /mobile, then we're going to create a new path, prepending it with mobile. And by the way, we're going to take off the /, from whatever the current nav path is. So you can do whatever you want to here. You can say, hey, you know what? If it's index, go to the mobile index. But if it's these pages, like counter and fetch data, those are fine. Just let the CSS work its magic. But if I want to build a completely different page that's mobile for mobile devices, different UI, right? Different strategy, a lot of things not there, a lot of things look different, then I can do that this way. And I can cherry pick which ones I want to show if we're mobile. But I'm using a sort of convention over configuration approach right here. So what we're going to do is we're going to create a mobile page, a mobile counter page, and a mobile fetch data page. And so if we're mobile on a mobile device and we navigate to those, it'll reroute us to the correct mobile version. So let's make those pages now. Actually, I'm going to create another folder called mobile pages. And there I'm going to create mobile index. And I'm going to create mobile counter and mobile fetch data. So let's start with fetch data. Here's our mobile index and mobile counter. So you can see all I've done here is, besides the page directive being, you know, mobile counter, whatever, I've just set, you know, something that we can identify this as definitely the mobile version of this page. In this case of the counter, it still has the code to increment the counter and the button and all that stuff. That's exactly the same. In the case of index, this is just going to be called mobile because, remember, this is the path to the regular index. So this is just going to be mobile. And as for fetch data, this will be called mobile fetch data. All right. So again, host determines whether we're on a mobile device or not, creates the app with the parameter isMobile. Okay? The app gets a nav check uninitialized, and anytime that there's a navigation, checks to see if we are mobile and the path that we're asking for is not mobile. And if it isn't, then we're rerouting to a new path that is mobile. Now, how do we test this? Well, I'm using Chrome. My web browser is Google Chrome right here. Google Chrome has a nice feature where you can sort of emulate a mobile device. So I'm going to press F12 and then Shift Control M. And there's our mobile. But why isn't it saying, you know, why doesn't it tell us that we're on a mobile device? Well, because remember, we have to refresh in order to reload that CS HTML file. And now it's mobile. You can see mobile index and it's slash mobile up there. If I go to counter, there's our mobile counter page, and that works just like you'd expect. And our mobile fetch data page. And by the way, you can see our mobile fetch data page. We took the Celsius completely out of that, whether we're, you know, this wide or this wide, right? Just to show you that you can do something unique. Now, what happens if you want to navigate in your code directly to one of these pages, but not to the mobile page? Well, that's what you do. You write all your code, even in your mobile applications, to navigate to the non-mobile pages. And then this nav check will do the work of making sure that you get to the right page. So let's go to mobile index. And let's just add a button here. So the button is to fetch data. And when we go to fetch data, it's navigate to fetch data, the non-mobile version, right? Well, let's see what happens when we do that. Now, this is from the mobile index, right? All right, F12, Shift-Control-M, reload. Now I got my fetch data button, click that, and look at that. It's gone to the mobile fetch data page automatically. You don't have to do anything. All right, so I'm not telling you which one you should use in your project. Obviously, there's three different approaches. You can use a combination of all of them. You know, start with CSS if you think that's going to be easiest for you, just showing and hiding elements based on the width, or, you know, completely changing the way things look with CSS based on the width. But if you want to know if you're on a mobile device, you can use this method. And if you want to use JavaScript to determine the actual width so you can examine it in code, then you can do that as well. I hope this has been an informative episode of Blazer Train. Back to you in the studio, Carl. You know, CSS purists will tell you that using media queries is the only way to go. That's the accepted modern way to do responsive UI. But what if you're months into a project and the boss says, oh yeah, you got to make this app work on an iPhone? Well, now you have options. Move up to business class. Hey, thanks for riding the rails with me today. This is where I jump off. I'll see you next time. Blaze the Train!